This is an interview with George James Daley, the 19th of December 2002, approximately 11:30 a.m. It's a home interview, 15 Van Buren Lane, Scotia, New York. The interviewer is Michael Russert. Could you give me your full name and date of birth and place of birth, please?
My name is George James Daley. I was born December 28th, 1922. In Spring Lake, New Jersey.
Okay. What was your educational background prior to the war, to your military service?
I graduated from junior high school in 1939. That was the last actual school.
Mm-hmm. There are two things that you mentioned in your form here that predate the war. I'd just like to talk about those a little bit. You were present when the Hindenburg,
Hindenburg
disaster.
One of my uncles called me, came by my car. He said, "Let's go out to see the dirigible burning." And see, I was living in around Asbury Park at the time, and it was still burning when we got there. And it was. Oh boy. I can't remember what year it was.
1933.
Yeah, that's. And I think the year before that was the Moore Castle burn.
You saw that also?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I was down right on. I lived down right on the. Right next to the boardwalk in Asbury Park. And I could see it burning and coming in. And. One of my uncles, at low tide, after it came in, at low tide, the sand was right up to the hull of the ship. And they ran a plank up to a door there, you know, a cargo hatch there. And one of my uncles was putting emergency lighting in. He's an electrician. And another one of my uncles was a fireman. He says, "Come on, bud, let's go take a look." And we walked inside there, and it could stink, whoa. Mm-hmm. You know, from burned bodies and all that. And my other Uncle Charlie says, "Get him out of here." But I saw the whole thing from what burning off the coast and then coming in. Mm-hmm. Quite a sight.
Yeah. When you heard about Pearl Harbor, where were you and what do you remember?
Well, I was. Reaction? I was in Toledo, Ohio. I was going to Signalman school, and it was on a Sunday. I was out sitting in a guy's house. I met this young lady. Mm-hmm. Was sitting on the couch just talking, and her father came in. He says, "What are you doing here?" "We're not doing anything." And he says, "Have you had the radio on?" I said, "No." He turns the radio on, and when the first thing he said, "All military personnel report to your station immediately." "What the devil's going on?" He says, "They just bombed Pearl Harbor." That was how I heard about it.
Mm-hmm. What was your reaction? Did you have a reaction to this that you recall?
Not really. It doesn't sink in, I don't think, until a little bit later.
So you enlisted prior to Pearl Harbor.
Yeah, in August of 41, I was working down around Asbury Park in New Jersey, and I decided that, heck, I'm going to go in the Navy. So another guy and I got on a bus, went up to 90 Church Street, if I remember right, in Manhattan. In the recruiting station, and told me we wanted to join the Navy. So they started giving it the physical and all that. And we went out and had some lunch and came back. And I said, "Where's my buddy?" He says, "Oh, we turned him down early this morning. The guy never said a word." So then he said, do you want to sign up for reserve 2 years, or you want to go in a regular Navy for six? And I said, heck, sign me up for six. So actually, I was, when Pearl Harbor came along, I finished boot camp. Just on the 28th of August, I went on active duty, went to boot camp.
Mm-hmm. Let me go back a second. Why did you pick the Navy?
One of my uncles was had been and it was in the, had been in the Navy, and I don't know. I just kind of liked the idea of it, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I said, that's where I want to go. In fact, I was going to go in and try to get in the Navy down in Washington, D.C. I guess was in April or May somewhere. And I got at the enlist, went down to enlist. And I got turned down because one of my toes sits up a little bit. I couldn't make it. I told a guy, he goes, you're out of your mind. And he says, oh, no. He says, but if you want to go into service, get down the hall, they'll take you in the Army. They said that my toe was wrong, so I couldn't march. And they told me to go in the Army.
Where did you do your basic, your boot camp?
Newport, Rhode Island. Mm-hmm. That was one of the, there was only, I think, three at the time. It was Rhode Island, Norfolk, Virginia, and San Diego, as far as I know.
Now, you said when you heard about Pearl Harbor, you were in Ohio.
Yeah, I was going to Signalman School.
Okay.
And, you know, they give you an exam when you go in to what type of work mm-hmm. you should be able to handle, I guess. And the way it turned out, they sent me to Signalman School. And we're almost finished. And right after that, they moved us to Chicago, to Navy Pier. There was a Signalman School there, and they joined the two together to finish up. So, in fact, Christmas Day, I was in... There was a servicemen's center, and Mayor Daley and his wife were serving us dinner.
Really?
When I told him my name was Daley, he says, oh boy, and I didn't meet his wife. And that was the old mayor. Mm-hmm. So right after that, I got a set of orders. Finished up Sigma School, and I got a set of orders to Norfolk Navy Yard in Portsmouth, Virginia, to an attack transport, the USS John Penn. What they were doing, they were taking cargo ships, American export cargo ships, converting them into attack transports. So that was my first assignment.
Well, what were your duties on that ship?
Well, as I say, see, in those days, all communication was visual.
Mm-hmm.
So signalman, you had to learn semaphore and flashing light and flag hoist. And so you... that was your job at sea. But like when the ship, we're getting ready to put this ship in commission, we were standing fire watches. You know, they'd have welders. We'd have to have, they had to stand by with a fire, with a fire extinguishers. Mm-hmm. And you stood all kinds of watches. Mm-hmm. But it was just... kind of rough duty until the ship was ready for commissioning and then start out to sea. Mm-hmm. And then we had they started practicing landings, beach landings down off the coast of Carolina. And I was in a Signalman, in a commander's boat, and they had about, I think, 7 or 8 boats going in towards the beach.
Now, what kind of boats were these? Were these the old Higgins boats? Or?
Yeah, the old ones. Mm-hmm. And in the commander's boat, they were all pretty much the same. But he told me, he says, tell boat number 5 to speed up. So I get up on this engine housing with a pair of semaphore flags. And I stopped and I said, wait a minute. I said, we're heading for the beach and they're shooting at us. And you want me standing up here waving these flags? And the commander looked at me and says, you know, that doesn't make sense. And I said, well, how about an Aulus gun? So they had a thing called an Aulus light. It was about a 6-inch light with a trigger. Mm-hmm. And he says, try that. And I called boat number 5. Used, you know, Morse code, mm-hmm. give him the message. And he says, that's a lot better. I says, no kidding. So anyway, after a couple of months there, the Navy came out with an order. They were putting so many ships in commission and training that they said no more than 10% regular Navy on a ship. Mm-hmm. So that meant I was in the regular Navy, I was on a 6-year cruise. There was too many of us. So I got a set of orders to had to go over to Pier 92 in New York to a receiving station. And then I got a set of orders to a patrol gunboat. It's called the USS Tenacity. It turns out that prior to World War II, when the British got into the war with Germany, we gave them 50 old destroyers. And in return, when we got into it, they gave us 10 corvettes. Those felt like a bathtub, get out. Roughest riding ship in the sea. That's what this was. This is called a gunboat. So we started, after I got that, went aboard there, got that in commission. This didn't take long in any of these now. We started running convoys down the coast of, we left New York down to Charleston and took a convoy out of there down to, I think the first one was Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. And we took, after we got down there, we started running convoys between Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, and Trinidad. And then we lost a few ships. The subs were all through the Caribbean. But after we'd had a few trips like that, I guess quite a few, then we started taking the convoys from Trinidad down to Recife, Brazil. And the reason for it was, this was, I've got to keep in mind, this was after the North Africa landings, okay? Well, the subs had the entrance to the Mediterranean and that area pretty well tied up. So what they were doing was sending these ships down to Brazil The shortest distance across the Atlantic was from Natal to Dakar. So they were taking priority stuff down there and flying it over. So after they caught on to this, like one night we lost something like 6 ships in a convoy. They hit us. But we're back and forth between Trinidad and Recife. And so I was in, I guess it was around August of 43. Our ship was going to go back to the States. I got transferred to the flag, Commander 4th Fleet's flag, signal tower in Recife on the beach. My ship went back to the States. So, after a month or so of there, I told the signal officer, I said, this isn't for me. I'd rather be at sea. He's okay. It's his first ship in. So in comes a light cruiser, the USS Marblehead. And he says, here's your new home. So I was a first-class signalman then. And I went aboard the Marblehead, and it was a lot different going from a small patrol gunboat to a cruiser. But it didn't take long. I enjoyed it. So we were running the cruisers had destroyers with them, and they were, what they're doing is running a blockade across the South Atlantic, because the Germans were trying to bring ships in from Malaya and, with rubber, optical instruments. What else was it? It was stuff they needed for the war. Mm-hmm. And they were disguising ships, merchant ships, to make them look like they were from another nation and fly their flag. So I got assigned, one of the things I got assigned to was the boarding party. That was joyful. We'd stop these ships out at sea, the cruisers going around them. We get in a motor whale boat with about 8 of us, go alongside the ship and up aboard up a Jacob's ladder. And they weren't too happy to see us. But I'd go up to the bridge with a pair of semaphore flags and keep in touch with them if anything, you know, if they started shooting or anything like that, the cruiser'd sink them. So anyway, we did that for a while, chasing. We would run from Recife out across and sometimes over near the Dardanelles, no. What's the name of that? The Aleutian Island. No, the Aleutians, not.
The Azores?
Yeah, over around the Azores, back and forth. Mm-hmm. And there was 4 cruisers, each one had a destroyer with them, doing this. So some of the ships, like the one of our sister ships, the Omaha, went to board one, and the crew was going off the other side into longboats, and they had opened up the seacocks and set off explosives down in the holds. So there was bales, big bales of raw rubber floating around out there. And actually, they sent tugs out from Brazil to hook onto these bales and tow them back in. That's the kind of stuff that they were trying to get through to. They wanted to get into the, they wouldn't try and go up through the English Channel. They'd go Bay of Biscay, I think, is in France. Mm-hmm. and that's where they're trying to get into there. So
I've got to ask you a question here.
Sure.
You wrote down here, you were able to cross the equator 22 times before you got initiated. How did that happen?
Second time I got initiated.
Oh.
I got initiated on a small ship.
Uh-huh.
And, but they didn't put it in the record. You know, it's a small ship, they didn't pay attention to that. So here I'm on this cruiser, and I've been running convoys back and forth across the equator.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, well, it's not your record. So I had to go through initiation again. There was a lot of things like this. For some reason or other, I've lost my shellback certificate, you know, the big one.
Mm-hmm.
I know what happened to it.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Oh. You know, on a small ship. But on a Tenacity, we used to go in Trinidad. The guys would go ashore, and they come back with, like one guy had a monkey on a, you know, about so big.
Mm-hmm.
Had him on a leash. Another guy, they had a little, they got one of the radiomen got a puppy. And that puppy grew up on that ship.
Did you keep the monkey on board too?
Well, we did for a while. They had the monkey, a couple of guys brought back parrots. And I happened to get a hold of a couple of marmosets. Marmosets, a little tiny monkey. And they'd cling to the hair on the back of your hand. You know, you walk along. And they were cute little things. But the one of the guy was walking with it, stepped on it. That was it. But the one night, all these things got screeching and yelling. The old man got dump them, out at sea. The only thing he let him save was the dog, the pup. And it was funny, the guy that owned the dog, we were in Trinidad. He said, I'm going to take him ashore. And that poor dog, he got on land, and he was like this. He was yelping and crying. You know, he wasn't used to the
roll of
the ship. But that dog used to go up and down the ladders and everything. So there was a lot of stuff like that. We went to a lot of places that skipper of the ship got a liberty for us one time to Santiago de Cuba, and towns up on the top of a hill, and that was where Teddy Roosevelt made his
Rough Riders.
And I looked at that, and I said, man, from up, you know, it was like that. Those guys were going up against fire from up there. But we had a heck of a liberty there in that town. We didn't get much liberty on that town. The only time it's the Guantanamo Bay, there was no liberty. You went to a movie or something like that, or there was a canteen, you could get a can of beer. Trinidad, that was kind of rough. Down in Brazil was great. So, that's kind of...
How long were you on the Marblehead?
Let's see, I eventually put it out of commission after the war in Philadelphia. But we were in, we had to go in for some repairs into Rio, to a dry dock, down in Rio de Janeiro.
Mm-hmm.
And we finished up there, and they got orders to of February of 44, they got orders, make a speed run to Bayonne. So now we've been down there in the tropics for all these years. Zoom, we go running up to Bayonne, New Jersey, and it's snowing. Cold. You really feel it then. We were just there for a few days and took on fuel and supplies. And we took a troop ship and tankers convoy up through the northern route, up through the Arctic Circle, over to Ireland. But they were getting ready for the Normandy invasion. So we made a couple of those trips. And we anchored in Belfast Lough. That's quite a town, too. But then they get ready for the invasion. They wouldn't let our ship go. We didn't have enough type of guns that they wanted. So they sent us down to the Mediterranean, took a convoy of ships down to the Mediterranean to add to the ships in there. And we tied up, pardon me, anchored out in a harbor in Oran, which is part of Algeria. Please call it Merzil Kibar. The holy Arabs. Yeah, I want some water. Thank you, honey. And so then they sent us out with certain places they wanted covering fire up through Italy. See, the army was coming up through Italy, and like I was in Naples. We were out in the bay. The harbor was full of sunken ships, so we're in the bay there. But we anchored one night there, and you could see the gunfire up on the, artillery fire up on the hills above Naples at night. Then they had us bombard a couple of places, covering fire. And so now we got various places around the Med, and then they got ready for the invasion of southern France, and they said it was this is a beautiful saying: four ships expendable. Two French and two American cruisers. And they had minesweeps lead us in towards the beach, and we laid to in the dark. No lights, nothing. And of course, this was before, he didn't have all this radar and stuff they got now. So we were in 2,000 yards from the beach, and with 6-inch guns, that's point blank. So we went there about 3 o'clock in the morning, had to wait till sunrise. And then a flight of B-25s came over, and that was nice. One of they opened their bomb bays, and one of them must have had a loose bomb. It landed just off our bow. But they dropped their bomb loads, and then we had a targets that we were supposed to fire at. And then all the landing craft went in. You know, we do wait till anybody to ask for covering fire. Then it was a... I had a, you know, a single bridge. I had a good view of everything. Binoculars and all, like, there was a mine sweep. When he's shallow, one of the in, they call them harbor mine sweeps. He went close, and all of a sudden the front end was gone. You know, they hit a shallow water mine, and so then it was an LCI was trying to land troops. They were coming in, and I could see out of it was a chateau. I could see gunfire coming out of a window there. And they'd back off, the LCI would back off, and they said, "Can you give us a hand?" The exec says, what do they want? I said, "Oh, there's a gun over there. It's bothering them with trying to land." He says, "You know where it's at?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Go up, tell the gunnery officer, and lay it out for him." So went up on the next deck, and I showed the gunnery officer where it was at. They swung the forward twin 6-inch over, and da-doom. Ship come in, no problem. So that, you know, that's the kind of job it was. One of the best ones I saw was, here are all our cruisers, all the good ships that weren't expendable. They were 7 or 8 miles out, loping shells over us. All right? Here comes this British destroyer. Just come sweeping in. Here on deck, there's Winnie.
Oh, really?
He's up there waving to us. All our people way out. Mm-hmm. Here Winnie comes in. I always got a kick out of that. But anyway, after the landing, people don't ever think about it, but it right at sunset, our planes had been out of North Africa, covering us. We had control of the sky. Sunset, they left. Here comes the junkers. So everybody's, all the transports and all the ships are circling, get out of the way, trying to avoid the planes. And everybody's shooting up at them. And nobody thinks about it, but you know, that stuff explodes up there. And it comes down like rain. And like on a open signal bridge, like the old cruisers, you know, we had helmets on, but you keep all your men undercover. And I had all my guys undercover. The exec came running out, he says, "Are your men all undercover?" And I said, "Commander, there's only two of us, not you and I." And would you believe it? A chunk of metal took down, hit the deck, and bounced up and hit him right in the crotch. He passed out. So we called for corpsman, they got him in out of there. But that's, you know, you don't think about it, but that stuff was coming down. But all these ships firing. So then we left the area, went over to, we pulled into a harbor for the night. Not an actual harbor, a place called Ajaccio in Corsica. We went in there, laid to, till morning, and then went back out to cover the transports or anything you needed. So that was about what it was like in an invasion. where else we go? We went back to the States after a while, and they sent us down to Annapolis to take a midshipman cruise out. And when the war ended, European war, over we had these cruises, midshipman cruises, things like that. Then they took us into Philadelphia Navy Yard, and they decided they're going to put these old cruisers out of commission. See, my ship, the Marblehead, was put in commission in 1922, and so they were figured outdated. So Japan quit. They took four old cruisers, the Marblehead and the Memphis, I think the Omaha, Phoenix, can't remember for sure. But anyway, four of them in one dry dock. They went in there and were cutting them up, making riffs in the Gillette for razor blades. But that was a funny thing, to live on a ship and then see it just cut up in chunks all out of there. So I got went to the receiving station, and I walked in there. I was chief signalman then, and there was 11 chief signalmen sitting there, and I said, oh boy, I'm going to be all right on the bottom of the list. 10 days later, I get a set of orders. Going up to New York, picked up the USS Philadelphia, another cruiser. And we went back into Philadelphia, came down to Philadelphia, and they're going to put that out of commission. But they didn't cut it up. It was one of the cruisers they sold to one of the South American countries. And so after getting that one out of commission, as well, went back into the receiving station. These guys are still sitting there waiting on orders. So I said, man, I'm going to be here a while. 10 days. I got orders to the USS Canisteo, big Navy tanker. I said, what the devil? Somewhere in a bureau they had a big sea duty next to my name. So we were running fuel from Lake Charles, Louisiana, and Port Arthur, Texas, up to Argentia and up to Greenland, fueling the bases up there, back and forth. And we'd stop in, for enjoyment, they stopped, spend a day, like a holiday, dry tortugas down in the Caribbean. But it was good duty, but I'd only been married a short while on this.
When did you get married?
I got married in 45. We were in New York. I was on a Marblehead and met this gal. We got married. She stayed in New York, and then we went down to Philadelphia, and she came down there. I kept telling her, I said, I'll be right back. I kept going. Where else did we go after that? Oh, so I was on a Canisteo, on a tanker. And we went down to Guantanamo Bay, and I told the skipper, I said, look, I got 110 days leave on the books. I've been at sea the whole damn war. I want 10 days leave when we get back. He says, I can't spare you. Well, the Bureau just put out a letter. It said if you had more than 5 years in on a 6-year cruise, you could request get out. And I didn't want to get out, but I said, look, I need some leave. So he says, can't do it. So I said, okay, you're going to have to transfer me back to States then. So that's when I got my first airplane ride. In a big PBM Martin bomber goes across the water and takes off. Flew up to Jacksonville, and I got discharged there and went back to Washington, where my mother was, parents were, and my wife came down there. And I got a job right away. I worked for Western Electric, putting in telephone exchanges, all the new dial equipment and all that. I worked for them until things started getting rough. I started to lay off. And I got caught in a layoff, and I went to work for National Security Agency in Washington. And we were working on crypto equipment. But this was civil service, and boy, I couldn't take these guys. If you try to work, do a job, they totally kept telling you, slow down, slow down. What the hell with this? So the Korean War started. I went down to see if I could get recalled to active duty, because I was in the inactive reserve as a chief signalman. And they said, "Well, we're not recalling any chief signalman." I said, "Well, how about if I reenlist? What'll I get?" So I reenlisted as third class quartermaster. So I dropped from permanent appointment chief back to third class. And went to the receiving station in Washington, wait for assignment. And they gave what they call a dream sheet. Put down what kind of ship you'd like. So I wanted a light cruiser, a destroyer, or a large auxiliary. And I put down there, please, no bird farm. The orders came in, USS Wasp. So they sent me up to Brooklyn Navy Yard to recommission the Wasp. So after we went in commission, we were getting ready to go. I went through the shakedown and all that stuff. They were sending us over to the 6th Fleet over in the Mediterranean. And on the way, doing some night maneuvers and we had a collision with the USS Hobson. And I think they lost 167 men. cut the ship right in half.
It was a destroyer, wasn't it?
It was converted from a destroyer to a destroyer minesweep. But I was on watch on a bridge, on a signal bridge, and I saw it. They were on our port bow, and I told the guy there, I said, that's the Hobson. Keep an eye on him. I walked through the superstructure there over to the other side of the bridge. And I saw their lights came right across our bow. So the rodman was, we were doing 32 knots. We started backing down full. When they saw the ship cutting across the front of us, we couldn't stop. You don't stop a carrier. I ripped the hood off a 12-inch searchlight and told the rodman, emergency, that collision. And so they swung away because they were heading right for our fantail. They didn't, you know, was backing down, they were coming. So they turned off. So all the boats were out picking up survivors where they could. They told me need another signalman. I went down, I got in a motor whaleboat. We were out looking for survivors. We got some of the clothing, you know, in the water. It caught in the screws of the boat, and we just went adrift. We're drifting, and the ship was going one way, and we're going the other. And they had 60-some planes up in the air. They had a get up enough speed to land those planes or they'd lose the whole batch of them, you know. So here we're out in the middle of the North Atlantic and adrift in a motor whaleboat. It started getting rough and there was oil all over the place. We were sick from the smell of the oil in the water. And the destroyer spotted us. And they got us aboard. Getting us aboard, they sunk the motor whaleboat we were in. They get banged up and they just sunk it. So they sent word back to the ship the next day. Said either you have to get these men off, or we'll have to take them to the Med with us, because the rest of the task force was gone to the Mediterranean. So it was too rough for boats. So they decided they brought a helicopter over, and they lower that horse collar, and you just get in that, hang on, take you up. So. Believe it or not, I was standing there, this thing comes down, and the guy next to me grabs a hold of it to steady it. And right above the horse car, there's a ball about that big, heavy metal ball to keep it, you know. Boom. Hit me right between the eyes. The blood started coming out. The exec says, get that man to sick pay. And I said, sick pay, hell. I got in there and they're going up. And these guys in the helicopter almost flipped when they saw me with the blood coming. So anyway, got back to the ship. And you know, no matter what the tragedy or what, there's somewhere along there's always some humor. You got to see humor somewhere. I got back there. I had a sick bay, they patched me up. I was okay. I ran into a friend of mine as a storekeeper, and he said, whatever you do, get down to the ship store and get a box of Kleenex. That's what She says, just do it. Don't ask any questions. Just do it. I said, okay. So I went and I got a box of Kleenex, put it in my locker. The next day, now we're limping back to port. I can't make much speed because they lost the part of the bow and it was shored up. So all around the ship, all around the heads, all the lockers open, and any toilet paper is all gone. Where's it stored? In the bow. Where's the bow? The bottom of the Atlantic. They lost all the toilet paper. So you can figure about 2,200 men. No toilet paper. You go in your locker, you get a few Kleenex, stick them in your pocket. And the other part, we pulled into, we've been at the Bayonne. The first thing, there was a crane there, these big crates, toilet paper. That's the first thing that came aboard. So, after they passed us, we put a new bow, they put a new bow on. And they sent us over to the Mediterranean and joined the Sixth Fleet. And we visited a lot of places. One place very few people get to go is of course, the Dardanelles, of course, the Sea of Marmara, up the Bosphorus, up to Istanbul. That was quite a trip. And we were all around the Mediterranean there for quite a while. 6 months, I think it was. And so we were in place called Augusta Bay, Sicily. And the next day, we're leaving for the back to the States. And if you remember, when I was down in Brazil, my ship went back to the States. I got left in there, Brazil. So the night before, they grabbed me and said, "Hey, we got a set of orders for you." What's this? He said, "Well, there's a ship over there needs it." I was first class now, a first class quartermaster. He's a quartermaster over there. I would tell him I'll ride that ship back, you know. So I pack my gear up and I get over. They sent me over in a boat. And I'm putting my stuff away and I says, "Hey, going back to the States, huh?" He looked at me kind of funny. I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "Oh, we got another year to do over here yet." So here I am stuck again. Our home port was Cannes, France. And we used to anchor up in the bay in Gulf Juan.
What ship was that?
This was the USS Menelaus. It was a converted LST, converted to a aviation supply ship. So we'd go, as the carriers in the Sixth Fleet were going to be in the port, we'd go there and wait, go there ahead of them, and have, if they needed spare parts and stuff they needed, and we'd give them to them, you know? So, this way, we just traveled all around. So, when I went aboard there, though, they said, "The reason we need you," they had a chief quartermaster who was, time was up, and he was getting transferred back to the States. "They're going to teach me navigation real quick. I went, holy mackerel. Here I've been a signalman all the time. So I had a crash course in coastal piloting, dead reckoning, and started using the sextant for star sights to navigate. So I was learning all that stuff. I learned it. I stayed on that ship for, we'll see, 3 years. I navigated that thing across the Atlantic twice with a sextant.
How did that handle the sea?
Rough. Outside. In fact, we hit a storm one time going across, going back to the States to where the expansion joints, those ships had an expansion joint. Well, this thing tore. And we went into Bermuda, someplace in Bermuda there. And they welded a railroad tie, you know, across on the deck to brace it till we get into Norfolk. And after we finished up there, well, we went back, let's see, we went back the first time. They changed our home port from Cannes, France, over to Naples, Italy. And I had a good time over there. Took leave one time, spent a week on Capri. 3 day weekend up in Rome over New Year's. So I had a good time.
We're going to put the tape in. Okay, we're ready again.
Okay.
Why don't you tell us, what was the difference between the LST and the
Corvette,
the way they handled out in the open seas?
Well, a Corvette, if I remember right, 205 foot long, wider a beam than a destroyer, and they're just a rounded hull. Mm-hmm. So they're like this all the time. Mm-hmm. LST is long and flat, and it would go up and down like this. So it's according to the type of sea you're in. Mm-hmm. But entirely different feeling, but you get used to any of them. I rode out a couple of hurricanes with the Corvette. Also, we was in a hurricane with the LST, and that's the worst, because we were in Chesapeake Bay, and they put down two anchors, and because of the way the length of the ship, it would go like this. We dragged two anchors over 18 miles in a big circle. So the law of storms is that the winds go this way and the course goes this way. We used to have to study this stuff. But actually, you look at any of the, when you're watching the storms in on your weather channels, they'll show you that the arc is this way for the path of the storm, and yet the winds are going this way. And that's, we used to use that to see which way to go in a storm, in a bad storm, where we could put the wind on your stern or on a quarter and push you right out of it instead of going with it. You know, if you got room though. But I don't know. I guess I'd rather I wrote any of them. Let's see where else we go. Oh, what are we talking about? Oh, the an LST, the Menelaus. This might be interesting. We were in Greece, and were we popular? You know who Menelaus was?
Yes.
King of Greece. Mm-hmm. And his wife was Helen.
Helen of Troy.
So it is, we pull into his port in Greece. The Menelaus, man, they were great. And we went to, we took trips. You know, I've got a lot of pictures of the Acropolis and the, all around Athens and all. And where else we go? Oh, it was on a, it's a place called Elvesus in Greece. And it's called a playground of the gods. And back in the days when the Roman Empire came through, to kill their gods, they Elvesus, they had the statues of all the different gods. They cut their heads off. So we did. But the sailors, we get up behind when the statue was just your head up there, and the guys would take pictures. So I learned a lot, I'll tell you, traveling in the Navy and all. The you figure, I graduated from junior high school. Didn't have any formal education, but I learned a lot in the Navy. And one of the things is this, on the Menelaus, the skipper was a pilot. You know, this because the way the Navy's set up, we came under air land. In other words, all the carriers, the auxiliaries that worked with them, are under air land. The auxiliaries, regular auxiliaries, come under service force, Atlantic Fleet. In other words, there's different control of the ships, where they go, what they do. So anyway, they would send pilots out to these jobs. For instance, on the Menelaus, a lot of the officers would be young pilots who were learning. I think they had to get so much time doing certain things that others go up in rank. So anyway, this captain, he was a full commander. He came aboard there and he says, got me aside, he says, "You tell me what I'm doing right or wrong." It's okay, Captain. So one time he was going into dropped the anchor off of Naples. And I says, "Captain, I don't think you want to go any further." And this instance is, "Chief, you don't talk to the captain that way." And he says, "Get out of here. What am I doing?" I says, "You're on the wrong, he's taking sights." I says, "You're on the wrong sight. Just stop, back out of here." Oh, he did, and I showed him. That was fine. One night we left Naples, and we're heading towards Sardinia, And we had to pick up some lights and then get down the coast of Sardinia. And it was a storm. It was pretty stormy, and we were getting set. See, that's another thing with this LST. The winds had more effect on you because the high bow pushed you. So you're always fighting to come back. And I was up on a bridge, and I looked and I told the officer of the deck, I said, you don't want to go any further. You're going to hit the rocks. You're going to be on a beach. He says, I got this thing under control. He says, I'm about to light this light. I says, you got the wrong lights. You know, you can tell by the timing of them, the number of flashes. Yeah. So I said, well, let's talk to ask the captain. He said, no. I told the quartermaster on watch, who worked for me, I said, get down and wake the captain up. He says, don't you do it. I said, get down and wake him up. He said, kid goes down. The captain came up and he says, what's wrong? I said, just go 180, go 180 and get out of here right now. He did. And I showed him what was going on. We were really heading for the beach, you know, hit the rocks. So the old man got all the officers and he said, when that chief tells you something, listen. So we just like that. He was good that way, you know. But being a pilot, they have to fly, get so many hours a month in flying if it's available. So there was an airport outside of Naples that he decided he was going to go do some flying. And there was a Navy beach craft there. Well, we were going from, our next assignment was to get down to another part of Italy. And I was going to be on the beach as running up a shore patrol. So a place called Toronto, Italy. So he says, well, we'll fly down there. And to get down, we met the people, we did all our business. Then on the way back, he says, I still got time. I got to get some more flying time in. So he's buzzing down along the beach around Capri and Sorrento and those places. So then he decides, he says, hey, let's see how things look in Vesuvio. So he starts going around at Mount Vesuvio and banks that thing over like this so we can look down in. I'm saying, get out of here. I didn't go for that thing. So after we landed, he says, join in. I says, I'll never fly with you again. But there was a lot of good times like that. But then he says, my enlistment was almost up. And he says, what do you want to do? And I said, you know, there's a letter out that you can put in for electronics school. They had a lot of young people who could learn electronics, but no older people that knew the Navy. So they wanted people, first class and chiefs, if you had high enough marks to go to electronics school and convert over. So here I was, I'd been a chief signalman, and I was a chief quartermaster, so I'm going to go to electronics school. And they went to, they sent me to Great Lakes. And they said that they put a put us through a 2-year college engineering course in 11 months. Holy mackerel. Now you can figure, I'd never been to high school. So I had there was a lot of math I had to learn, you know. And I'm studying at night. And anyway, I made it. I end up with ulcers. Here I was carefree all my life, and never thought it would bother me. And I get studying, and I get ulcers from it. So they had a call it this conversion. So now, instead of being a chief quartermaster, I was a chief electronics technician. So they sent me to the USS Vulcan. It was a large repair ship, Norfolk. And here's the beauty of this. I reported in. I walked aboard. They said, "Don't unpack your gear. We need a chief ET on temporary duty on the USS Regal, which was getting ready to go to sea that day." So I walked aboard the Vulcan, transferred over to the Regal, and went to sea again. And we were down in down the Caribbean. I guess it was a shakedown cruise or training exercises. And we went into Havana. And I got to see Batista. And Havana was something else. This was just before Castro took over. That was 1956. And you've heard of Sloppy Joe's, where Papa used to go, Hemingway. Mm-hmm. Sitting in there, they had a small TV set, and they had the fights on. And see how these people were. The end of the fight was over, and the people didn't like the decision. And this place is crowded, and rant, and all of a sudden, machine guns. And here this place was full of people. And you looked, there was nobody in sight. Everybody's under the seats, under the ring. Down there, they didn't take the cameras off. They swung around. I had these guys up there. So that's kind of the way it was then. And we were anchored off what they call a fleet landing, anchored out. And we were getting ready to get out and get to our boat. And they stopped all the traffic on this boulevard. And they had a double line of soldiers across the street. And here comes Batista walking. He's got guards around him, but they put all these, so nobody get near him. One of our guys would go over to try and say hello. Wrong thing. But anyway, they got into a boat and went out to his yacht. That's the way things were in those days. So We went back to Norfolk, back on a Vulcan, and we did repair jobs, and electronic repair, and so numerous things that happened in there, you know. Where'd I go from there?
You have on the sheet the Naval Air Station in Washington.
Oh, that was in Italy. Yeah. Kim reminded me. Was on a, over in Naples. You get to know a lot of people, you know. Mm-hmm. But there was an outside coffee place, or like a tables outside, a little fence around it. I go over there and I sit down and have coffee. Lucky Luciano. Mm-hmm. That's where he went, you know, when they kicked him out of the States and all. Thought that there, thought I'd have a cup of coffee with him. I got to know a lot of people there around Naples. And like one of the things later, this friend of mine, I used to go to, right off of Fleet Landing, there was a big hotel called the Hotel Londres. Albergo is a hotel. The Londres, which was for word for London. And we'd always stop, and Antoine was the, Antonio, the waiter, the head bartender there. And we always had a drink with him and talked. Then we'd go up, out on the night. But years later, I got back into Naples, and I went in there, and the kid that had been the best busboy was tending bar. And the guy that had been the bartender was now the manager. And he said, you got to have a drink. I said, well, I can't stay long. He said, oh, yeah, yeah. They had called, the old guy had retired. He came back to have a drink with me after all those years. But it's odd. You meet people around us. I had friends in France, too. There was a place called Piccadilly in Cannes, where we all went. And I, Susie ran the place, and her husband, Roger, was a good friend. Were you supposed to be off the street in uniform at midnight or something like that? I'd go in there and I'd see. I got to take off my coat. Go up there, he had an apartment above the place, the restaurant. I put on one of his jackets. I'm in civilian clothes. We had, I got pictures somewhere of New Year's Eve there. You wouldn't believe the big parties we had and all. There's so many places, so many people that I've met and had fun with, you know. Morocco. Which one? Oh, you mean you're going to the Casbah? Yeah. We went in too. And we went in Tunisia. And Tunis is about 40 kilometers inland. And we got, some of the officers were gone, another chief and I said, how about a ride? Come on. We're going to leave at a certain time. Go back. If you're not there, we're going to leave you. Said, okay. And they had warned, whatever you do, don't go to the Casbah. Okay, so that's where we went. Phil and I get out in the Casbah. We're sitting there with these Arabs drinking and having a good time. And we decided we better get out of there. Guy got across to us, don't worry, nobody's going to bother you. We walked up the street. There's guys in dark doorways and all. Nobody bothered us. We went up in the Tunis was the headquarters for the French Foreign Legion at the time. And Phil and I both had gold hash marks. So we walking by and a sentry He wants to see some rugged people, those French Foreign Legionists. This guy snaps to with a salute. With his gun. We salute him. Phil says, what's that for? I said, we've got gold ass marks. You see the gold? Salute it. But then we went to a joint there, and there was a Tunisian guy there who was telling us about running in with some guys he didn't like. He opened his shirt and he had stab wounds all over his body. And the way we're talking is there was a Mexican bartender. I can speak quite a bit of Italian and some Spanish because I've been around here. In fact, I thought I was speaking French. There was a gendarme out there. And Phil, this guy Phil was with me. I started in French to tell this guy, this cop, that we were going in there if the officers came along, that they let us know we're over there. Phil says, you know what? He says, you start out in French, you ended up talking Italian to the guy. He understood me. They understood all those languages, you know. So anyway, we get in this bar, the Mexican bartender, and this guy's this, he spoke Arabic, so we're translating back and forth and trying to talk. And in comes the skipper and the two officers who are with him. And we're supposed to leave at 11 o'clock. This was around 12. About 2 o'clock, we decided to get out of there. Everybody is loaded. And these two, we get back to by the ship. And these two young officers, they park the car, and they get out, and they walk away. The captain's out like a light. Phil says, yeah, you better wake him up. Okay. So I'm slapping him. He says, you don't have to beat me up. I says, get up. I'm not going to go anywhere. I'm going to go to sleep. I said, you got to go aboard ship. I got him awake. We made it. But how he got up that gangway, I don't know. He and I got to be good, pretty good friends. His wife he had his family over there. And it was his place one night, putting his kids to bed, telling them a sea story. And his wife come aboard ship, and she say, did you get my old man loaded the other night? Not me. You know I don't drink. Yeah. I had a lot of fun over there. Where did I go from there?
Well, after you said you were in the Vulcan, and here it tells you went to the Naval Air Station in Washington.
Oh yeah, I got a set of orders. You got to remember, this was the first time I got shore duty orders. Every time I got orders was out to sea, or overseas somewhere. So they sent me to Naval Station Anacostia, Naval Air Station. And I had all the electronics on the base. And got out of training and working on the equipment for the Not the radios that were in the planes, but the communications to the planes and all. So we had all that stuff, and they gave me a whole bunch of young guys to train, and we got ready for like they sent. I think it was about 10 of them. Sent me 10 young kids in. They were getting ready to go to electronics school. waiting for the next opening. And so I had to start teaching them basic electricity and basic electronics. And had classes set up and worked out great. These guys all made out like burglars. They were ahead of the rest of the class when they got there. But that's when I came down with my ulcers were really bad. They sent me up to Naval Hospital, Bethesda. And they decided that they had to operate on my stomach. So they took 3/4 of my stomach out and repiped the plumbing in there. That's the way they treated ulcers in those days. And when I got released from the hospital, they said my enlistment was almost up. They said, "Do you want you want a duty where I didn't have to do much?" And I don't care what the heck they call it. But I figured if I went on the kind of duty where I couldn't do a regular job, I may not be able to ship over. And here I got 18 plus something like that. So I said, "No, I'm going regular duty." So I got a set of orders. It was a ship over in the Mediterranean that needed a chief ET. So I moved my family from Norfolk up to Lakehurst, New Jersey. The ship's home port was New York. So this would be the nearest place I could figure. It'd be a commissary and a hospital, take care of the family. By that time, I had what? 3 kids? Oh, while we were at Naval Air Station, Kim's little brother died. And he's buried in my plot there at Arlington. He got sick. They said it was a overwhelming septicemia. The blood is some kind of a, I guess he got bit by something and just went like that. So anyway, after everything got, well, that was before I went to the hospital. After I came out of the hospital, I moved him up to Lakehurst. And they took me up to, what's the name of that airport in New Jersey? Big military airport.
McGuire.
Left me up to McGuire, and they put me on a, and this they first came out with a 707 jets. And those things went up over 30,000 feet. The odd part of it, all the way over, I couldn't close my eyes. I was wide awake. And I tell you, those things are so fast. We were going to Germany. They started letting down over England. We were to land in Germany. That's how fast those things were. So I got there. I had a set up, my orders were to go to Naples. So I went to, what the hell's the name of the German? Lusanda. Flew me from there to Rome. I picked up an Alitalia from Rome to Naples, and I just missed the ship. They just sailed. So I had to sit around Naples for a few days till I find out where they're going. And they said, okay, they're over in Balearic Islands. I'd been there before. What a place. So I got a set of orders. They flew me from Alitalia to Nice. I got a plane there, Air France to Barcelona. And from Barcelona on the that Spanish airline. I forget now. Over to what the devil was the name of that Balearic Islands, Kim? Oh man, great place. I guess many of these places going around in my head. Anyway, my ship was tied up there. And I reported aboard, and I ran into his chief bosun mate was getting dressed to go out. I dumped my gear and I said, let's go. I went back ashore. It turns out that ship, the USS Tanner, that's the most seagoing ship in the Navy. It's a survey ship, unarmed survey. And boy, that's unbelievable where we went. We were surveying various places around the Mediterranean. Then they sent us, they finally sent us back to the States. And we went from, we went into New York, which was the home port. Place I'm trying to think of, Palma, Mallorca, is where we were. And I'd been there before, and that was beautiful. So anyway, they sent us down to survey. They were getting ready for a problem down in Puerto Rico, and they sent us down there to survey a place called Roosevelt Roads to set up a new anchorage or harbor channels. This trouble they're having about bombing a certain area down there, and also Puerto Rico was they were having problems with the government in Puerto Rico, too. So my understanding was we were down there to survey them. Then we surveyed the Straits of Florida. And they sent us sent us over to Scotland. Rosyth. One of the can't think of the name of it. Anyways, right across from Edinburgh. Firth of what? Anyway, Scottish Bay, they call it a firth. So we went in there and took on all kinds of supplies and stuff, and it went up. They found out that the Russians were having their war games, and they had told the United Nations they drew a line across the Barents Sea. This line, don't any ship try and come in that past that line. So they sent us up to a place called Tromsø, Norway, up a fjord. And from there we went up around the tip of Norway over into the Barents Sea and started surveying up that way. But staying west of that line that the Russians had put. So as soon as we got up there, they picked us up with their planes, and they sent a ship. Everywhere we went, it was like this. The ship right behind us. We're only doing 3 or 4 knots while we're surveying. And they stayed with us the whole time. And the odd part, we went up there in August. And you may not believe it, but you can't go to sleep. You have trouble going to sleep. It's light all the time. Down to Chief's Quarters, sitting there playing pinochle all night. Because it'd get a little bit dusk about midnight. And then it's bright. So by the time we left up there, it was in October. It would get light about 9:30 in the morning. It'd be dark by 3. That's how bad that is up that way. So anyway, if you remember, let me get this straight now. Kennedy stopped the Russian ships from going into Cuba. Remember that?
Missile crisis.
Right. Put the blockade in there. Where are we? We're up there. So luckily, the day that they did that, we were in Tromsø. The next morning we start to go out, and there's 2 Russian cruisers waiting for us. And here we're an unarmed ship. And we got antennas all over the thing. So they must have figured we were just monitoring some of the things while we're up there. So the skipper says, oh no, we're not going out there. So we turned around, went back into Tromsø. And we waited until the Norwegian Navy told us that the cruisers had left. And we made a speed run down to Scotland. And then we went back to the States. They sent us down to Cuba, or down to the Straits of Cuba to monitor there. We had a lot of communications equipment on there. We were monitoring everything that the Cubans were doing. We're just cruising back and forth at 3 or 4 knots off the coast of Cuba. And we watched the fights on Friday night and their television.
Do you know if you had any CIA on board your ship?
Not CIA, but we had
intelligence, naval intelligence?
Sure. In fact, I gotta get a letter of commendation for repairing some of their stuff. Stuff I never heard of before, but I learned. So anyway, we stayed down there. And till the Cuba, everything quieted down, they sent us back up. Oh, they sent us back over to Scotland. And I got a set of, no, we went back to New York. And I got a set of orders. What had happened? I was due for shore duty. And one of the guys that had been with me at electronics school was getting out. And the job he had was up in Maine. And the skipper there asked him, he says, do you know of somebody who you'd recommend for this job that you're leaving? He was a senior chief, and by that time I was a senior chief. And he told me my name. So then they contacted me and told me to request that station for my shore duty. And the skipper from up there went to the bureau and asked for me by name. So he figured, I'm not going to get that. Nope. I got a set of orders, said Scotia, New York. And the devil's in Scotia, New York. So I get up. Oh, before I go, get up here. The skipper of Tanner, I'm getting ready to get transferred. I got most of my clothing and stuff, gear ready to go. He says, leave some of your stuff here, but you're going to have to ride, stay with me for this next trip. I said, why? He says, you got to break in this new chief ET. So, I had to ride the ship back to Scotland. And we get over there. They get this new chief straightened out all the stuff that we're working on. And gives me a set of orders. If one of the officers said, I would give anything for that set of orders. Here's what it said. Leave the ship, make your way to Prestwick Air Force Base, Prestwick Air Base in Scotland. It's on the East Coast. I'm on the West Coast, Scotland. I'm on the East Coast. And when available, air transport's available, proceed to the United States and then start your leave to report in. This guy says, this officer says, man, I'd go by way of Paris, London, you know, full pay. They pay all your expenses no matter what. I said, yeah, I know. So I had met a gal who is and her husband in the British Chiefs Club, and got to be fairly friendly, you know. And he's telling me about his kids and all. So I said, "Geez, I got to get to a place called Prestwick. It's over near it's on over on the West Coast." He says, you know what? we're going over near there. You are? He says, yeah, we're going to drive. I says, I want a ride. He says, sure. He had two kids and one of these little cars. So here he and his wife and two kids and me in this little car all the way across Scotland. And what a trip. You know, I got to see everything. We get to Prestwick and I report in there. And I found the Chiefs Club and I took the family in there for dinner. They thought that was the greatest thing going, you know. And so I said goodbye and all. And I went over and reported in. The guy says, I don't know when we got a flight going out. Okay. So I was in the Chiefs Club. And this guy calls me, says, I got a flight going out if you want to go. Sure, let me get back to family. And we get on there, it was C-47 cargo planes with bucket seats, propeller driven. Across the Atlantic, we landed in Goose Bay. And then went down, landed at McGuire. Oh, wait a minute. What was the one in Boston? Anyway, we landed at one in Massachusetts and then down to New Jersey. So then I got my family together and we moved up here to Scotia. That's when I found out it was the Correspondence Course Center. All the Navy correspondence courses were handled here. And I'll tell you, in the fleet, they didn't have a good reputation. So, I reported in. They said, you got all the electronic courses in the Navy. I want you to go through them, take out the bad stuff, correct any of this. I said, well, there's all kinds of trouble with that. They said, well, if you know about them. But they had a bunch of civilians that didn't want things changed. And I had to answer letters. You see, all the reserves, people in all the different reserve centers and guys in reserve were taking these correspondence courses. And they had questions about this, write a letter. I had to answer the letters of where they were correct or wrong and explain it to them. And I had been dealing with all kinds of people as a chief. And here, the guys that had to review the letters, the civilians here, they're going by, well, this isn't the correct English for this. I said, wait a minute, I got the letter from the guy. I know how he's talking. You want me to explain it so he'll understand it or not? And we fought all the time like this. Finally, the skipper told him, let him put it in his words so that they'll understand it. And we got along good. But that was the thing. They had all the electronic courses we had. A couple of times we had to go down to Washington, D.C. to get some of this stuff straightened out. And there was one place I wanted to change things. They weren't about to let me change it. So there was a whole bunch of high-ranking officers sitting with us. And I said, wait a minute. Have you got an ET around here that's been out in the fleet? They said, yeah, it was a chief. Calls his chief in, and I said, have you ever graded the second class exams? He says, yeah. I said, what'd you do with this chapter? He says, you changed it because they're wrong. And these guys went, oh. I said, now, the thing was, if you knew the equipment, you couldn't pass that test. If you went by the way they had it worded and all this. So then he says, okay, change it the way you make it right. And I got to change a whole bunch of stuff. So I was gonna retire out of there. And as Chief Yeoman said, you know something, Chief? By then I was a master chief. He said, if you stick around another 14 months, you'll one heck of a pay raise in your retirement. Okay. So I call a bureau. There was a desk in the bureau for master chiefs. And you could call and see what your assignments are available and all that. So I called, told him who I was, and he looked at me and said, hey, you're the most senior chief. You can have anything you want. So I said, what do you got? He started naming off carriers. I said, no bird for him. Been that route. I said, what else you got in here? So he named a couple of places. Then he said, hey, got a repair ship in Newport, Rhode Island. That's it. He says, the USS Cadmus. So, it's okay, that's for me. He says, your orders will be in the mail. So, I'll tell you something that any old Navy chief can tell you. You can step aboard a ship and know whether it's easygoing, regulation, or what. And I've been used to, up here, I was the chief master at arms, as well as the master chief of the place. You weighed all kinds of stuff, you know. Walked aboard that ship, I whooped. This is regulation. And it was. But you know it right off the bat, and you go with the flow. So I had, I think it was 11 shops. I was the chief of the repair department for the electrical, all the technical stuff. They had watchmakers. All these different shops. And it turns out that in the division, I got 109 men. I'm the senior chief. They had a chief warrant officer, and of course a lieutenant for division officer. They both turned to me and said, "They're yours." So I'm responsible for their training, everything. So they, as far as repair stuff went, electronics was the ones I had to worry about there. So we did a heck of a job. And these ships were happy. We're getting the ships, getting the work done. When the time was up, I retired off of there. They had the 8 senior chiefs on the ship, the side boys, to pipe me over the side. And Kim, all my wife and kids were there. And that's the way I left the Navy.
What year was that?
1968. 41 to 68. That's a pretty good tour.
He was the admiral who had dinner with that time, that there at the cabinet?
Yeah.
He almost got in trouble?
Oh, he was chief of staff of the flag was a skipper of mine. And I ran into him in Newport. And while I was on the Cadmus. And I saw him, I said, hey, old boy, we're talking, I'm getting along great. And I said, hey, I was mess caterer for the chief's mess on the Cadmus. I said, why don't you go over and have dinner with us? He says, how about tomorrow, okay? I said, yeah, fine. Have a nice steak dinner and all. Great. So I'm telling the rest of the chiefs about it. And this other, the chief, master chief bosun mate says, did you let our skipper know? I says, no. He says, I think you better. This guy's pretty senior to him. So he runs up and tells the captain. And the captain says, oh, I'd be delighted to have dinner with him. So he came down. We had two of them there in the chief's quarters. But there was a lot of people that I ran into that I really got to know well and liked, you know. I had a good life in the Navy.
These four photographs.
Okay. This guy is.
Now, where are you in any of these?
Oh, it's me in the middle here.
Okay.
These were guys. We were on the Tenacity on there.
Mm-hmm. This is he in the center.
Yeah.
And this is you here.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this guy over here was in boot camp with me, and his sister sent me letters all during the time I was at sea during the war.
Hmm.
This is in Rio de Janeiro.
And this is you here?
Yeah, the shortest one. There's something odd for you. See where the rating badges are?
Mm-hmm.
In those days, all the senior rates were on the right arm. Now everything's on the left.
Now he's carrying his are in his left.
Yeah, he's in a black guy.
All the rest are.
It's according to what your rate was.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They call it a black gang. Engineering.
Getting glare. Here's another Rio de Janeiro. That's you here.
Yeah, these here are Revere Beach outside of Boston. I remember that. This is in Miami. That's me here.
Tanner.
Yep, that's a survey ship.
You get a shot of the discharges.
Yeah, I got a bunch of those. Let me find that.
Okay. A couple more. It looks like you spent a lot of time in and out of the Navy with all those discharges.
Well, you got one every time you shift over.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Okay, now where were all these taken?
Okay, this is a signal gang, my signal gang on the Marblehead. This is on a Marblehead down in Cuba, I think. this is the bow and the 4-inch gun on the Tenacity. You remember he asked where I was when Pearl Harbor hit? This was in Toledo, Ohio. My people invited us over for dinner. That's me here. This is in Bahia. I remember that, South America, down in Brazil. Where are we at?
This is the Marblehead, I believe, Marblehead.
Well, that's the Marblehead towing the Cincinnati. See, that's, they had a, what they call a towing exercise.
Plane and the Marblehead, on the back of the Marblehead.
Yeah.
The catapult.
Oh, see this? Mm-hmm. This is a tanker I was on up in, this is in Greenland. A big iceberg there. This thing was a certificate of the Battle of the South Atlantic. You can see the ice flows. We were running up a tanker with the 4 tanks full of high-octane gas. Mm-hmm. And some of the areas, these are guys in kayaks, fishermen. But they had to have a icebreaker pushed at times, pushing ice out of the way for us to get into these places. So I remember these. These were down in Haiti. I was on the Wasp. Over Haiti. This was on the Wasp. I think all of these are on the Wasp. Okay.
All these are in the Wasp. This is the Wasp here, yeah.
Yeah. These are all guys on the Wasp, too.
Do you ever keep in contact with anyone that you served with?
Occasionally, but not lately. Mm-hmm. You lose.
Is this the Wasp here, or is this another carrier?
Must be. That may be the Wasp when I was on the other ship. Mm-hmm. These are all in Greece.
You're getting too much flare if you can throw that one.
Yeah, these are the Parthenon and the Acropolis. Mm-hmm. This is downtown Athens. Off that picture of the statue of the gods or not.
No.
These are all. Here's one for you. Officers on the Menelaus.
think you enjoyed yourself.
I did. That's Naples. CDs over here. Mm-hmm. But I made chief quartermaster after starting over again. I got initiated on a ship. This is my, this is down in Miami, Florida. My youngest, or my oldest son.
That's quite a car, too.
Yeah, the Mercury. Oh, give me a Highland Capri. It's been a week on the Highland Capri. 2 weeks of leave. So I was the judge, the chief's initiation. They took the senior, whoever to have a chief's initiation. Whoever's the chief, senior chief is the boss there.
Is that?
That's the USS Cadmus.
Mm-hmm. That was your last ship?
Yeah. Okay. What's the date on this thing? Geez, 61. Yeah. Okay, this was when I was leaving. I just retired here. Here's the side boys. Graduation group in 1939, isn't it?
39.
This was I was shipping over for the last time in Scotia. In Maryland, I think.
Can't tell any fish stories about that one. You got the pictures of them there, huh?
Right.
Can't stretch them.
You know the odd thing? Okay. I used to love fishing. And I learned to play golf, but I didn't go fishing again.
How about the time, Dad, when you all go off the ship and then shark circling
for? With the what?
When you all go off the ship to go swimming one time.
Oh!
Sharks and barracuda.
down in Cuba, down in Guantanamo Bay. First time we pulled in there to where we tied up to the pier, and it was hot. We asked the skipper, can we go swimming? He says, yeah, go ahead. So we're diving off the fantail there. And this captain comes running down the pier yelling. Our skipper comes out there and he says, get those men out of the water. He says, they hurt going swimming. So anyway, he gets off on deck. And he says, I want to show you something. He says, see this? They had a wooden pier. He says, what is, you see that? See those logs underneath there? Says, yeah. He says, they're not logs. They're barracuda. Yeah. They're about that big around. Holy mackerel. Nobody going swimming there again, I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
Was
diving off the ship, and the ship wasn't stopping.
Oh, out in the middle of the Mediterranean, well, on the Wasp. You know that the flight deck elevator?
Mm-hmm.
They put it down, and they had swimming call. Hey, you know, it didn't look real far. I dove off of there. They could have read a book on the way down.
I was gonna say, if that was up there quite a bit.
Well, you don't think about the height of it until he dove off there, and I went down a ways, I'll tell you. I came back up, and the fantail's going by. They thought the ship was stopped, but it wasn't. It was a whole bunch of us in there swimming like the devil to catch up with it. They would put lines over for us to climb back up. But that's a funny feeling, I'll tell you, when you don't realize how far it is.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your interview.
I've enjoyed it.